at this, see? Is that enough for you?
Brought to you in part by St. Croix Rods, best rods on earth. Strike King Lure Company, number one in fishing lures. Ardent, pure performance, all American. This week on Extreme Angler TV.
Got him now. Got him now. Nice one too.
I've got a new trailer here that I'm real excited about from Strike King. I love throwing a football jig.
We'll be right back.
Hey, welcome back to Extreme Angler TV. You know, this week I'm going to talk about a couple things that are pretty important to anglers, and that's about color. Color of stick worm, color of rodent, jig. But you know what? Topwater. Big misconception. We're using frogs, walking style baits like the Sexy Dog and the Spitting King. Does color make a difference? And you know what? It's up to the angler. Myself, I've got a variety of different colors, of different baits. Today I'm going to try to catch some smallmouth with the Spitting King, okay? Maybe the Sexy Dog too, depending on the mood of the fish. But I'm going to vary the colors depending on what I think those fish are eating, okay? It's usually the perch, bluegill, sunfish, maybe smelt, and things like that. But just, I'm not so that picky about actual matching the hatch. As long as it has some tones like bait fish, and maybe some chartreuse, or maybe orange dots or orange bellies and different things, just a little contrast. The fish can see it and see it looks like something it wants to eat, something that they have eaten. So we're gonna go back and forth. I'm gonna show you some of the colors that I use so you can use them on your lakes and catch fish too. Let's go have some fun. Yeah, I'd say, hey, somebody feeding early in the morning? Somebody real hungry? That's what you get when you go first thing in the morning. And you pick sort of the right color on top. So that's when you loosen up the drag. Just let them fight a bit. Let them have some fun. That's what you're here for. Look at them. Not a bad way, eh? Boy, oh boy. Gotta love those Spitting Kings, man, oh man, oh man. Because they find them fast. Put you all the pieces of the puzzle together. And this puzzle is called topwater fishing. Look how much spunk they got. It's summertime and the fishing's good. Look at them go, eh? Tell me you can't like that. Look at them go. Tough, tough fish. But this is what it's all about. You can get them and scoop them in the net. Look at that, eh? What a way to start my day. And there's no problem. Look at him. Not a bad way to start, eh? We'll put them in there. I'm gonna take some pictures of some fish. But boy, when they boil up first thing, you know you picked the right color, right presentation, right cadence. That's what we're gonna do today. All the right things, put it all in pieces together to hopefully catch more and bigger smallmouth bass on top. That's what the focus of the show is. Picking the right topwater to match the conditions and color. I get asked by so many people so many times, what different colors do you use a lot? I see your show, you catch a lot of topwater fish, whether it be a frog, walking bait, or a popper. And for me, I pick baits that give me confidence. Throughout this morning and day, I'm gonna show you what I use, so you can use, so you can catch them just like you saw there, and they end up there, taking some shots, then let them go. Let's keep going, and hopefully the rest of the morning is something like, well, like you just saw. Now when I'm fishing topwater, the Spitting King, and I'm on a flat, like I am right here, I'm gonna make long casts. If you watch a show, you know that I usually fish right in front of me. Docks, weeds, pads, everything. Deeper weed, right in front. When it comes to trying to find fish, especially those smallmouth, the little pods that are moving around, longer casts will find them. I'm not worried about losing fish, because if there's one, there's gonna be more. If I let that bait just sit there and just shake it a few times, they'll show me if they're there. And there's a good chance that there's more than one fish. I call it the seagull factor. They try to come up and eat it. So the most aggressive one's gonna come flying up. So he'll tell you, that's where we are. Put your bait here. And if you miss that one, there's a good chance there's other ones there that you can still catch. They might not eat the topwater. Have a stick worm, drop shot, or something else ready to throw in that same area where you missed that fish or caught him on the long cast. Like that. See? Just like that. And let it sit. You leave it there. And a good one too. That's when you gotta back off the drag just a little bit. No big giant fish, just a nice fish. Look at that topwater. Gotta love it, man. Just a small fish. But a fun fish to catch, huh? Look at that. Sometimes that's how they eat it. Look at that, right near the bottom. So you know he's rolling on it. And the best way is just to grab him. Grab your pliers. A little shake and bake. You see sometimes how they eat it. If that popper's on the bottom and stuff like that, so they're almost like rolling on it, and not almost hitting it with their mouth open. They're like stunting it. But different colors. Anything with that sexy shad. A little bit of green, chartreuse, and this part of the bait stays out of the water. This all goes down. So you think about color? Yes, that's what they can see. Is it triggering them? It is so far. Let's keep going. Okay, when it comes to color of topwater, you know what? I don't have a real wide selection like I do stick worms and rodents and things like that to match the hatch in different areas. And to an extent, okay, I don't go too crazy with regard to exactly what they're eating, you know what I mean? Because you can't match the color of a mosquito, can you? But I mean, when it comes to topwaters, the sexy shad with some chrome, a little bit of blue, green with chartreuse, black, the things that fish eat, you know, perch, bluegills, chub and things like that, natural tones. You don't have to go too crazy, but anything that offsets it with a little bit of metal flake, sometimes you get the little stripe on the bottom and that kind of things like that, or a little orange spot, that's all you need to hopefully trigger them. Because when they come over and look at it, that thing's sitting in the water, the last three quarters of these Spitting Kings sit in the water, they can see the color of it. They can just see it. Does that trigger them? Sometimes it does. The thing is, it has to trigger you having confidence throwing that particular color that you like. Two or three hooks, my friend. Wow. Come on up. Like that. See? Again, a topwater, huh? Take your time. You gotta let it sit there sometimes. It's psychotic, man. Reeling that slack. I don't think he's a real big fish. Oh, he's a nice one. Look at him. Look where he's got that bait too, eh? Look where you got that bait, right where you want it, in the mouth. Another hook's there too, we've got that bottom one. Those are those little power surges, eh? They pull and they pull, they act all tough. Who's your poppy, huh? Who's the poppy? Let him tire out. We're here for fun, man, right? Yeah, let's get him up. That's a decent fish, and he pops off. It's okay. But you know what? We found them, hooked them, caught them, boated them, catch and release. The sexy shad, I've got a few of them in my boat because you know what? Sometimes you're catching fish and stuff, you don't want to slow down. You got to always, you know, check, sharpen the hooks. But if you've got extra baits, you change it up, another one on, get back at it, new spot, cast in, and catch. Check the 18 inches, 24 inches, make sure it's cool. A little snap swivel. Just a little snap so I get a little bit more action. But you see, sometimes you gotta cast it out, don't do anything. Let it sit there. They'll find it. If they're in the area, they know it's there. Vary your retrieve, vary your coloration, you're gonna catch them on top. I got a feeling there's one right up here. Is there one there, Bubba? Huh? Great big one? Or is a big one sitting off the point? Where? Oh, that's a good one. I felt him. Oh yeah, he's good. Oh, I can feel some dead weight there. I can feel some dead weight unless he's got it sideways. And loosen that off a bit. Oh yeah, look at him, just nice. Oh, he barely got that, look at that. If he jumps like that, he's probably gonna spit it. Oops, I mean, he will spit it. He just barely had that in the nose. But you know what, again, it's finding them, working it out, figuring it out. You know, that's fishing. That's 90% of fishing. Right locations, yes. Everybody wants to know the GPSs and the lakes and stuff that you're on. Okay, that's one thing. But if you don't have the right baits, the right presentation and cadence and confidence, you're not gonna catch them. Put all the pieces together, then go to the lakes that you like to fish with the information that you learned from this show and maybe the ones that you do like. And you know what? You're gonna catch more and bigger fish on topwater because you just got the right color and the right confidence in the right spots. So I'll just move around. Let's see if there's one more on that spot. And here's something to consider. When it's really shallow and it's just quiet, at first cast, you gotta pay attention. You just can't cast and look away and stuff like that, because if he's within, I'd say 20 feet, that thing lands, he's feeding on this flat. It's gonna come right over. There's two or three, even better. It's like that seagull factor. They all wanna get it, and one's gonna race the other one to get it. So you gotta pay attention. If he misses it, leave it. You know what I mean? Sometimes they just bump it, leave it. You twitch it again, back they come. So just don't be too aggressive. Let them take it, feel the fish, lean back, and catch them. Like that. Missed them. See what I mean? Got him now. Got him now. Nice one too. See what I mean? You take your time. Whoa! Look at him go. Tough, tough little smallmouth. I think there's more with him too. Oh yeah, he's got buddies all around him. Holy cow. Right by the weed, rock. You look bigger in the water. You ain't that big, but you sure blasted it. You see how I left it there? He came back and he blasted it again. Gotta get him like that. Get reliable pliers. Look where he's got it there. Just in the corner there. He's gonna get the tension on that rod, boy. And so when he jumps and does all his little fancy stuff for the camera, he doesn't pop off. Just a chunky fish, huh? Look at that. Typical Northern Ontario smallmouth. Nice and thick back, healthy looking, beautiful looking fish. Looks like he just got painted. Let's let him go. Okay, go on you. Just cruising in those weeds, cruising the weeds. See, sometimes you fish those edges and stuff and you get those fish that boil on it in 9, 10, 12, 14 feet of water. As tempting as it is, in the mornings, they're still gonna be, I don't care if it's crystal clear on Lake St. Clair or Simcoe, whatever it is, or this tea color in northeastern Ontario, there's gonna be shallow fish. I mean, 2 feet to 3, 4, 5, 6, back and forth cruising all day. If the wind stays down, you can catch them all day long with the Spittin' King. It's just phenomenal. Now it's time for the Cottage Angler, presented by St. Croix Rods, best rods on earth.
Hi folks, Mark Rose here. I've got a new trailer here that I'm real excited about from Strike King. I love throwing a football jig, and traditionally, you know, this is the way that I normally throw the football jig with a Rage Crawl on it, but this new Menace trailer is one that I'm really excited about. It doesn't have quite as much, you know, wide tail on it, so it's gonna be a more of a compact trailer that's gonna still have lots of action to it. When I'm fishing a little bit deeper, or when I'm wanting a really reaction strike, I can work this bait a lot faster because it's more of a streamlined trailer. It still has a lot of that rage, traditional rage action to it, but it's tighter together, has a really quick fall. And anytime I'm fishing real deep or when I want to stroke a jig and have a quick fall, I like the Menace trailer. As you can see, this has a lot bulkier swimming action, but this is gonna be a more of a reaction type strike. The football jig with the Menace trailer, it's very easy to use. You just basically just cast that football jig out there and let it go to the bottom. When it gets to the bottom, you're just creeping it along the bottom. The football jig is a bottom contact lure. So you're just kind of sweeping your rod along the bottom like this. You'll just feel those rocks down there, tick, 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 and just keep sweeping it along the bottom, staying in bottom contact. Every now and then, if you're throwing a big heavy football jig and you see the fish down there and you can't get them to bite, but you see them on your electronics, you might want to give your rod a little bit of a sweep and give it a rip. And that's what I like about the Menace trailer. It's going to come up and it's going to fall right back down really quick.
That's her rod, medium power. The St. Croix Legend Tournament Bass, 6'8". You set hook, they have enough power for those trebles to find the meat. But you lean back, they have enough give when they get close to the boat, make those little power surges. And I rig them up with the Evercast Fishiflage. It's smooth, they make a long cast, smooth drag system for those little power surges by the boat. It's very important. You don't have to go out and spin and break the bank to have right tackle. But the St. Croix rods, everything from the Mojo to the Legend Extremes, the Evercast, the Ardents, you can't go wrong. Atty, about to give it a twitch. And I guess I found another one. He's all dark. He's probably got a school of them. Got that first one around weeds and stuff. See that real light bite? I lost some fish like that. We'll just let them fight. Look at that. Awesome, eh? Amazing, look at that little rod. Look at the power of these fish. See what I'm talking about when they swirl like that? They make those little head turns and jumps. Little power runs. That's when you got a nice soft medium rod. The good butt section here. See, he's not a big giant fish. Just a nice smallmouth. He might even jump off. I think we're just gonna shake him off unless he shakes himself off. Let's take it out. That's another one. See? Just a decent sized fish. No big bragging fish. But sometimes they just boil on it. I was just ready to just give it a little shot again. And the fish was already there turning on it. But that little sexy shad, you know, they're tearing it up a little bit. And hooks make a big difference. A few little tail feathers like that, they flare in the water. I'm telling you, it just triggers those fish that just want to look at it. You know that fish wasn't going to blast it, and he didn't, because he's just underneath it looking at it. I barely tried to move it. He had it. Let's keep going. It's those long casts you got to make, covering water. If I'm on a lot of fish, I see a lot of arcs and stuff, I won't go in the trolling motor. I'll slow down at the top water. If I'm on an area like this that's a big flat, and I want to cover water, and I'm not seeing a lot of hooks, long casts, stay on the trolling motor until you find them. Look at the weeds here, oh my God. What did I say, huh? Right by them weeds, huh? As soon as I saw those weeds off that flat, I was in 2 or 3 feet, came down about, it says 4, but it's really more down about 6. Doom, doom. It's fun to see them eat like that. They come out of the water, you all get excited. But I'm telling you, man, they come off when they do that. I didn't do anything wrong, just lean back, but boy, just exciting. But I don't like when they eat it like that. I like when they eat it out about 30 feet. I can lean back and hit them again. But it's still fun, isn't it? It sure is. Let's keep going. good one too. Look at that. Crazy one, huh? A crazy one. Set again. Look at that. It landed. He decided just to take a swipe at it. The topwater sometimes, it's amazing. Because they just look up and it's there. They take their time. Whoa, sometimes you just gotta let it sit for a second. You know, like old school. Cast and just let it sit. Then we'll come right to the boat. See, that one ate it. He did eat it. Look at him. Didn't you? You weighed it up, huh? Yep. And a nice little fat little belly on you too, huh? Where's them hooks? Ooh boy. Look at that. This one ate it. He didn't thrash at it, but it sat there. Do I want to go to the deeper fish, maybe suspended fish, or I want to go to the shallower ones? Remember one thing. Those fish, when they're cruising out of the deeps, in the shallow, it's like going on shoals and stuff like that. To me, those are feeding fish or looking to eat. Sometimes it can be easier to catch. Look at them, just a beautiful smallmouth, eh? No bragger. It's a beautiful Northern Ontario fish. Let's let them go. You earned your keep. You fought good. Go on, you. Sometimes fast, sometimes slow. Sometimes with the dark, sexy shad. You know, Arkansas shad, different colors. But for me, I tell you, anything with that little blue glimmer like that and green, it looks so natural. Chub, perch, sunfish, no matter what, they've all got green and blue on it. So when you pick a topwater bait, just like you do a frog or a worm, etc., those different tones, when this sits in the water, they see that little green and blue glimmer, chartreuse, that little feathers, they eat it. For me, that's the one. Well, I hope I answered a few more questions about color. You know what, when it comes to stickworms and tubes and rodents and all kinds of things, I got almost every color in the rainbow like a Christmas tree, just like every angler likes to have. Because you know what, we like to hoard things when it comes to fishing. All the colors, all the baits, we got to have it all. But when it comes to topwaters, there's four or five colors in the Spitting King that are just killer for me. The Sexy Dog, about the same. Remember, the greens with the blues, a little bit of orange, sometimes an Arkansas Shiner, real bone color in clear water. Just things that give you confidence. That's the number one thing. So next time you decide to fish topwater, you decide what color should I use. Hopefully this show will help you and show you that the biggest consideration is confidence. I pick colors that give me confidence to put the baits in those spots. So next time you go out, pick a color that gives you confidence, because you're gonna throw it where you should, work it the way you should, and catch bigger and badder bass. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time on Extreme Angler TV. Come on, fish. Time to go home. And if you want more Extreme Angler, go to our website, extremeanglertv.com, and I'm sure you'll find us on all your popular social networks, YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook, because I know you're gonna like us.